Hello, everyone. It's great to be here. Thanks for having me. I want to tell you a little bit about my experience helping to build Lyft from the ground up over the last 4 years. I've worn a lot of hats, like in any startup, there's a lot of change. So during that period of time, I've done everything from answering the customer support lines when Lyft was brand new to now working with federal, state, and local transportation agencies around the country to help them understand how services like Lyft are actually changing transportation behavior among consumers every day, how that's impacting cities, and how public transportation agencies can actually start to integrate this approach into the way that they provide mobility service. So first, I want to walk you through a little bit of Lyft history. It won't take long, because as I mentioned, we're only 4 years old. We're just a baby. We launched in 2012 in San Francisco, and very quickly started to see that we had hit on a magic formula. So in just that first year, we found, we had done a million rides. By 2013, we'd done a million rides, and gosh, that felt like a lot. Having started out as a tiny little startup with just a few people, I thought, oh my gosh, wow, we're really big time now, right? This is something people are responding to, the idea of point-to-point transportation. As you heard from Jose earlier, when people don't have to transfer between different legs of their trip, it was viral. It was something that people gravitated to instantly and would use as frequently as it was available to them. But in 2014, we hit an inflection point that really started to magnify the demand for this service and take it up to another level of scale. And that was the introduction of Lyft Line. At that point, we found that enough demand had grown for our system that there were so many rides happening in the same vicinity at the same time that we could start making serendipitous matches. Our technical folks would say that these rides were co-similar. There was enough similarity in the routes that multiple passengers were requesting to take that we were able to ask them if they were willing to pay a lower price and get paired up with those other riders so that we could create high occupancy rides. And allowing us to do that really increased the frequency with which people would take Lyft because it brought down the price so significantly. So with that new product, we were able to reach a whole new level of scale. We took that around the country, and in 2015, we had reached 200 cities, pretty much every major metropolitan area in the United States. Now in 2016, we reached 14 million rides every single month, not just every year, not just total, every single month. That's 168 million rides per year. So compare that to what we had reached total in 2013. You can see that over a very short period of time, there's been a virality in the demand for this service that really indicates that we are part of something bigger here, something that all of the speakers today have recognized is going to be a key part of the way that people want to get around moving forward, now that technology has made this kind of experience possible. So recently, our founder, John Zimmer, laid out a vision for what we're going to do with this platform that we've built. How are we going to take this forward? What are we going to use it to create? And how is it going to converge with other technologies that are coming on the market? So I want to share a little bit of that vision with you next. And it's really all about addressing the challenges that exist in our transportation system today. John went to the Cornell Hotel School. Not a usual background for someone who ends up working in the transportation business, but it taught him about evaluating a business based on occupancy and utilization. In the hotel business, they think about how many of those rooms are filled, right? And if you only have a few of those rooms filled, then you are running a failing hotel business. Well, he looked at our transportation system and he said, this has incredibly poor utilization and efficiency right now. This is a failing transportation business that we are running as a society. So we need to rebuild it, but we need to use imagination and technology to do that in a way that creates a livable experience for our society. So why does this matter? Lyft is a company that really has a social conscience. We started out really with founders who came out of a desire to work with urban planners, work with cities, and to create a positive impact in people's daily lives. So we start from the impacts that people have in the transportation system today. It has economic impact in that people spend such a large proportion of their incomes on transportation. So much of their time sitting in traffic, getting around, getting to and from their jobs, in too many cases, having to spend way too much of their time commuting and not being able to either get to that job on time or spend enough time with their families. Particularly now that we've seen so much suburbanization in our society for those in the lowest income brackets, as cities have become more expensive places to live. This is a cost that's increasingly being borne by those who have the least ability to pay. Of course, this utilization problem is something that impacts not just the occupancy of the vehicle itself, only one out of every five seats in a car is filled, but also the amount of time that vehicle is in use. So 96% of the time, vehicles are sitting unused on the road. We're engaging in massive scale idle vehicle storage in this country. And it's creating a need for urban land use dedication to this purpose, which is preventing that land in precious spaces, the closest to where people live, the closest to where they work, that could have been used for other purposes. So we see this not just as a problem, but as a huge opportunity, something that if we can fix it, can open up enormous amounts of space for better, more productive economic uses. Of course, this is a conference about mobility. So that is also a key feature here, a problem that we have to solve. Because as I mentioned, there's been a problem, a dislocation of people who now live farther out from the urban core, where it's easy to provide frequent, effective public transit at a low cost, now live farther and farther away from where they work. And that means that transit often can't get to them. Jose talked about that too. He highlighted what a problem that is, not only from an environmental perspective and a congestion perspective, but in terms of those folks' access to getting to the jobs that they need to get to living a freedom in their daily lives that allows them to move around. Finally, perhaps most importantly, we have a public health crisis in this country with the way that we use cars today. 35,000 people die in vehicular crashes every year in the United States. And the vast majority of those are due to human error. So in this era of intense smartphone connectivity, we have an opportunity to correct a problem that can greatly impact human life, greatly impact our cities. So how did we get to this point? I mean, I've just painted kind of a depressing picture, right? Oh gosh, you know, we're running a failing transportation business, people are dying. This is grave. It's grave, but you know, I think if we look back and unspool that a little bit to see how we got where we are, that it starts to point to the solutions. So we started out, obviously, as an agrarian society with very loosely connected communities where getting places was actually really hard. It was dangerous and slow, covered wagons and horseback. Then the first transportation revolution came along. Trains, canals, they facilitated the creation of cities and interstate commerce, move things one step faster. The second transportation revolution, the creation of the automobile, facilitating the kind of suburbanization that I described, which did accelerate our economy and sort of create this ideal of bucolic American life. But it also created really negative impacts in terms of congestion, in terms of environmental impact, and frankly, social isolation. As we moved farther and farther away from each other into our own little enclaves, there was something that was lost in urban life, in what people had appreciated about living in cities. And you know, to create this kind of suburban mobility, we actually physically cut up our cities often and put freeways through them. So this is something that in today's world, as new generations are starting to discover and rediscover the joy of living in an urban environment, there's a reevaluation of whether this is the right prioritization of infrastructure and land use, or whether perhaps we have an opportunity to reevaluate the way we use our urban land and our infrastructure itself. That's what we're hoping to do and think that we can do with the third transportation revolution. So what is that? What does that look like and how will it work? How is Lyft involved in this? Well, we believe it's going to take the form of shared autonomous vehicle fleets. And our partner in doing this is General Motors. We're excited to be working with them on a convergence of three different technologies: shared networks, like Lyft is today, electric powertrains, and autonomous vehicle technology. All of these three technologies make each other work better. They work better together than they do standing alone, and together present the optimal formulation of the rollout of autonomous vehicles. Let me tell you why we think that's the case. So this is the perfect manifestation of what that's going to look like. This is an example that's actually coming to the streets very, very soon. It's on your streets in a testing form now if you live in San Francisco or Arizona. This is the new Chevy Bolt. It'll be publicly released this winter, and as GM has said, it will come first to drivers on the Lyft platform who will be using it to provide rides to people on demand. Now, in the future, this will also be a vessel for the testing of autonomous technology. In fact, that's already happening with the technology GM acquired from Cruise Automation. Shared, electric, and autonomous. So John, our founder, predicts that within just 5 years, 50% of the rides on the Lyft platform will be provided by autonomous vehicles. That sounds crazy, right? A lot of people in the press, when this first came out a couple weeks ago with his prediction, said that's insane. This is unrealistic, Pollyanna, won't happen. But I'd ask you to think back to that growth curve that I just described a little bit earlier, where we went from 1 million rides to 168 million rides in such a short period of time. And then think about the inflection point that will happen with the change in the cost curve of introducing automation to the Lyft platform. It's actually going to engender yet another change, which is within 10 years, we predict that car ownership by private individuals will end in big cities. The reason for that is that when someone thinks about their monthly budget, a person thinking about whether or not they want to own a car, right now, as Lyft exists today with its current cost structure, ride sharing, providing that as a service by a human driver, they're comparing those costs and they're adding it up and they're saying, you know, if they're looking at that side by side with how much it costs to do insurance, how much it costs to pay their car payment, parking maybe, unless they live right in the middle of a city, owning a car might still be cheaper. It might be cheaper than taking Lyft most of the time. But in the future, that calculus will be flipped. With the introduction of automation, the cost of taking a Lyft ride will come down to pennies on the dollar of what it is today. In fact, we've done some analysis and found that even if a vehicle costs $500,000 to manufacture, $500,000 off the line, you put it on the Lyft platform, Lyft would cost exactly the same as it does today. But of course, we can see that the costs of production of those vehicles are going to come way down after those initial costly prototypes. And when we get into a mass market production, the cost of the vehicle will come down so much, and our ability to put that vehicle into high utilization on our platform with electric powertrains that have a much lower cost of operation than combustion engine vehicles is going to make it possible for people to take Lyft rides so much more frequently and for such a broader variety of use cases and longer distances than they do today that it will no longer make financial sense for people to own cars. So what will that look like on a consumer side? We think it's going to be a lot like your cell phone plan is today, where instead of having to think about all of the hassles of owning a car, where you have to worry about insurance and car payments and maintenance and parking and fuel, all of those things will be handled by the platform. They'll be abstracted from the user experience and rolled into a seamless subscription, almost like cell phone minutes, where you can take rides and not even have to think about that. Have it be something that happens pretty magically. And in fact, this can work increasingly seamlessly with public transit as well. I work a lot with public transit agencies, and there's a parallel trend happening right now in which public transit agencies are also starting to adopt smartphone technology for facilitating payment and ticketing with their riders. And so as they move into the digital realm and become capable of being interoperable with a system like Lyft, we can imagine a future where we have real-time APIs sending information back and forth about the availability and arrival, connectivity between different services, and allowing people to pay for those things with a single account that's really invisible to them. All of the engineering behind the scenes makes it easier and easier for people to live without owning a car and to have a complementary ecosystem of sustainable transportation services in cities. So this is not going to happen all at once. In terms of the transition from human drivers to automation, it will actually be a system which includes both side by side for a period of time. The way that we envision this rolling out on the Lyft platform is like adding a new mode into the app. So if you've ever used Lyft, you know that when you open up the app, you have a choice. You have a choice to take a classic Lyft or to take a Lyft line if you live in one of the cities where our shared ride product is available. and maybe a Lyft Plus, a larger vehicle. Well, in the future, we have the ability with autonomous to set up geofences, particular zones, particular corridors, areas where we're confident that at the stage of the technology at that point, that's a good location to provide that service. For example, in the early days, it may be important for us to make sure that the mapping of a particular area is up to a level of technological standard for us, or the state of good repair of the infrastructure, the lane markings, which need to be sensed by the sensors in an autonomous vehicle. Those kinds of things are things that we can take into consideration, especially in the early days of rolling out this technology, make sure that the place where we provide that service is one where we know it can perform extremely well. We have a lot of control when we do dispatch on the Lyft platform, even today with vehicles. So it's much easier for us to roll autonomous out in a controlled way than it would be if you just sold someone an autonomous car, which they could then go and drive anywhere. We can dispatch it only for ride types, origins, and destinations that are within the areas that we think are appropriate at a given time. And then as the safety, performance, and consumer acceptance of that service is demonstrated, expand that service to a broader variety of areas. So we think in the short term, this will actually increase the demand for human drivers on our platform as well, which might sound counterintuitive. But because of the reduction in cost that will come with introducing autonomous, so many more people will be able to get rid of their cars and use Lyft much more often. It will grow the market size for our business very significantly. And because we won't yet be offering autonomous service in all of our service areas, we think that will grow the market for both of our supply segments. But of course, over time, we expect automation to become the dominant form of supply on our platform, perhaps save certain unique needs that certain customers may have. You could imagine in the future, even with autonomous vehicles, parents wanting to have supervision for children taking an automated ride, or individuals who need assistance, may have cognitive disabilities or services of that kind. But this will be the dominant form of the way service is provided with Lyft. And increasingly, it will become integrated with public transit. And that's something that we're actually already laying the groundwork for doing, even with ride-sharing as it exists today. We've been increasingly entering partnerships with public transit agencies and cities around the country that are starting to identify areas where high-capacity fixed-route transit just does not work effectively. We're trying to put people in a large 40-foot bus or run it on a fixed route means that it's less convenient and too expensive in terms of subsidy for the agency. So like this area in Centennial, Colorado, the city has designated a zone where they're fully subsidizing Lyft rides for people to get to and from their light rail station, because they think that'll feed more people into their arterial train system, take those drivers off the road who would have driven all the way into downtown Denver, and make it affordable for a lot of people to use Lyft who haven't been able to use it in the past. So this is a technology with automation that will become available as a new layer on Lyft's technology stack. So think of it like wireless, where when a new technology standard became available, it rolled out first in certain areas. But as a consumer, you didn't have to think about it. It just shows up on your phone. When you're in an area that has that higher level of data connection speed, it shows up and becomes available to you. Similarly with automation, we will make that available within the existing Lyft marketplace so that wherever people are, they can count on the fact that they'll be able to get a ride. We have their backs, they'll get a ride somehow. And increasingly, there'll be autonomous rides as we grow the geography in which that is available. Why else does this matter? It matters because it can have tremendous environmental impacts. We talked about how the shift to electric powertrains is going to be a key part of our strategy for rolling out this technology. Well, researchers at Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory did simulations and found that if we rolled out a service in this way, they were not looking specifically at the Lyft platform, but basically a vision of the service that aligns with what I just described, shared on-demand vehicles being rolled out with autonomous technology, efficient dispatch, and electric powertrains, that greenhouse gas emissions would be reduced from our transportation system by over 90%. And oil consumption could go down to zero if they're all on electric powertrains. So that's phenomenal. I mean, it's one of those other things that it seems hard to believe, but it's because we're not living in that world yet that's been, you know, so directly impacted by the change in the cost structure that will come from this new technology. But we should anticipate it. Finally, I want to close by reminding ourselves what the problem is that we're trying to solve, and looking at how we can leverage the vision that I just described to recreate those cities that people want to live in, to address the issues that I described in the first two transportation revolutions and see how the third transportation revolution is going to restore urban vitality that we've lost. So our policymakers are recognizing this. They're recognizing not only that there's an opportunity to greatly improve public safety from the transportation system by eliminating vehicle crashes, but also to use this to change the way people live, to take this and turn it into this. The idea of repurposing infrastructure is something that urban planning circles right now are aflame with excitement about. They're looking at what I just described about all the idle vehicle storage that we have and thinking about the opportunities that it will represent for changing land use, for changing the amenities that we offer in an urban environment. Here's a famous example in New York City, which many of you may have experienced. There are many others that have started to proliferate around the country already, even before this technology has really started to impact infrastructure, and where we have reclaimed space and devoted it to human uses that actually make cities friendlier for people, bring people back into an environment where they are in interaction with their neighbors. And that really is something that we can all be proud of. It's something that I hope Lyft can be a part of helping to create. And I look forward to working with all of you on doing in the next few years. Thank you very much.